Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the National Employment Seminar. Glad you come by. We have an exciting guest today, and I'll get to her in a moment. But I did want to recognize the...
Hey, guys. It's Saturday.
Can you keep it quiet, please, and take your conversation in the back? Thank you. So I'd like to introduce my staff first. It's on stage here to my left. I have a brand new assistant employment director on staff. He starts next month, and that's Jeremy Yost. And the other assistant national employment director, Brian Burgos, has been with us since March. And he always rubbed it in that he's going to get diamond before I do with all this traffic. Anyway, I'd also like to introduce the interim employment committee. So sitting in the front row here is Joe Hall. Lisa Gregory. Jerome Washington. And one of the other members, CC Mazak. That's our employment, interim employment committee. They're very important to what we do. So this morning, we are very blessed to have with us a very important person. And I want to bring her up and introduce her. And I want to bring her up because she obviously is a busy government official and she has to leave to go to the airport. So without further ado, allow me to introduce. Ms. Margarita Devlin is the Deputy Assistant Secretary for Operations and Management at the U.S. Department of Labor, Veterans Employment and Training Service, known as VETS. She provides oversight to the entire portfolio of VETS programs and their $316 million budget. She is a senior career official in the agency. She has dedicated her entire career to service to American veterans. Prior to coming to the VETS in July of 2021, Ms. Devlin served with the U.S. Department of Veterans Affairs for over 25 years, where she began her career as a certified rehabilitation counselor, processed and progressed through leadership positions within VBA, DHA, and at the department, VA department level. Ms. Devlin most recently served as the Veterans Health Administration's Chief Learning Officer. Prior to that role, Ms. Devlin served as a Principal Deputy Undersecretary for Benefits in Washington, D.C. In this position, she was responsible at the Veterans Benefits Administration for the administration of benefit programs, including education, home loan guarantee, disability compensation, pension, veteran readiness, and employment, life insurance, and military to civilian transition assistance. Ms. Devlin is also a proud mother of two sons. Her oldest son is a veteran Marine who recently left active duty. The Assistant Secretary for Vets was not feeling well today, and Ms. Devlin filled in at the last moment. I'm very grateful that she did. We are grateful for her support and participation in our convention and her long service to support disabled veterans. Ladies and gentlemen, Ms. Margarita Devlin.
Thank you for everything that you do, for the over a million veterans that you represent. When I very first started my career at VA, one of my earliest experiences was working with DAV on the National Service Officer OJT program, working with bringing recruiting veterans into that program as a VRD counselor. And it was amazing, great partnership. The other thing as a rehab counselor that I always appreciated was my ability to, at the time I was at the St. Petersburg Regional Office, being able to go down the hall and talk to a DAV NSO when I was veteran in my office, who I knew needed something extra just to get over that, to get into the VRD program. Sometimes they had a 10% and needed a higher grade. And DAV was always there and always, there was always an episode of willing to sit with me and help that veteran work through the system. So I want to say I appreciate that partnership over many, many years with DAV. I am very fortunate at DLFX to have an amazing team, over 96% veterans, and even the employees that we have who are not veterans are typically from military families. I am not a veteran myself. I did not serve in the military, come from a military family. My father served in the Navy. My brother is retired Army. And you heard about my oldest son. And I have a nephew who's in the Air Force. So little by little, my family will cover all of the services. I'm trying to convince my youngest to go in college now, and he's on this track. We have over 2,800 people serving veterans in our organization. It's a combination of federal employees, state employees, contractors, grantees, and other partners. And so we have a wide network, and I want to tell you about how we serve veterans, and I will take questions at the end. And I want to tell you about a couple of initiatives and what our priorities are. We are in 6 regions across the country, between all of our organizational resources as I described. We're in military installations across the globe, performing the transition assistance program activities, and we are in American Job Centers nationally. We also have regional veteran employment coordinators that work directly with employers. And you may be familiar with the Disabled Veteran Outreach Program. We are the program that administers that grant that enables the DVOP and LVDR staff across the country. We have 400 contractors at over 200 installations worldwide with the transition, serving around 200,000 transitioning service members per year. And over 150 grantees supporting the employment needs of homeless veterans through the Homeless Veterans Reintegration Program. I have been on the road quite a bit, and so has my boss, Mr. Rodriguez. And as we go on the road, we make it a point to talk to veterans as often as we can. We're also talking to our grantees and to employers, and we've gotten some valuable insights, in particular talking to employers. I do want to talk a bit about the veteran narrative and how it's important to the success of our veterans in the workforce and also to our all-volunteer force. We have been a DOL that's very heavily involved of late in the effort to eliminate veteran suicide. And so, you know, it's interesting that VA obviously has a huge role in this. CDC, HUD is a multi-government effort, and it is very intensive right now with a lot of working groups focusing on the upstream effects and the protective factors. And one thing that we know is that employment is a protective factor. It's not just about financial security, although that is a piece of it. It's also about social connectivity. It's about identity. It's about purpose and mission. And those are all factors for resiliency that can help prevent that horrible event when a veteran dies by suicide. So we are all in for this effort. And what that leads me to is, what do we want people to know about veterans? And I'm going to talk a bit about the statistics about veterans. It really speaks to the fact that veterans, yes, they've been through a lot, and yes, we should lean in and make sure that they have the benefits that they've earned and the services that they need. And sometimes they do need a hand up, and we are there to give them that hand up. But the broken veteran narrative can be harmful to the all-volunteer force. So I want to talk about why I believe veterans are not working. Veterans are doing an amazing job, and the statistics and the data support that. When we look at the data, let's start with who can go into the military. And I'm sure you all know this. I'm sure I am preaching to the choir, but I'm going to say it anyway because it's important. According to DOD data, only 23% of 17 to 24-year-olds are even eligible to go into the military. The military services already are starting with the cream of the crop. They are starting with the best possible youth who can go into military service. And then what we also know is that veterans have lower unemployment rates than their non-veteran counterparts. At the Department of Labor, we have the Bureau of Labor Statistics, it's 2.7% is the unemployment rate for veterans versus 3.4% for non-veterans. That's amazing. We know that veterans come with a whole different set of skills, soft skills and technical skills, that employers are reaching for and seeking out, especially today. But let me talk a little bit more about why veterans are doing so well. Pew Research shows that veterans have a 17% higher standard of living than their non-veteran peers. That's amazing. The U.S. Census shows that post-9/11 veterans earn more than those who have never served and have a one-year job. And a LinkedIn study showed that veterans are 39% more likely to be promoted earlier than their non-veteran counterparts. This is a good news narrative, and we need to tell this narrative. Service to our nation facilitates a better long-term career trajectory than those who didn't serve. And this message is essential to the continuation of our all-volunteer force. And as you may know, the military services are struggling to meet their recruitment numbers. And the more we can talk about that military service is a viable career track. I'm a mother, as you know, and I know that when my kids were in high school, it was very frustrating to me to see. I'm all about pushing college, and college is super important. It is not the only way for a successful career. Apprenticeship is a viable option. Military service is an amazing option, and it should never be seen as the other option besides college. And that is something that I get on my soapbox for hours, but I between 180 and 200,000 military service members leave service each year. So it's not just about recruitment, it's also about retention. Retention is absolutely critical as well to the all-volunteer force. Why am I talking about the all-volunteer force? Because I'm asking for your partnership and helping to share the good news about military service being a great way to serve your country, but in addition to serving your country, having great career options following service. Reenlistment is a family decision. That's why, as Department of Labor vets, we are focusing extensively on military spouses. Military spouses have a big vote in what their spouse needs. And so with the blended retirement options that are available now, even more so, there's a lot of incentives to maintain service, to stay in the service. But if the military spouse is struggling with their employment with multiple relocations, they may not want their spouse to stay in the military. Frequent moves, heavy unemployment. Unemployment rates for military spouses are estimated at 4 times the national average. According to BLS, 38% of military spouses earn less than their counterparts. We have to address military spouse employment. Increasing employment opportunities for military spouses will help the armed forces retain important talent and maintain and enhance military readiness. We are leaning in on this. And if you look at our vision statement, when Mr. Rodriguez came on board, and then I came in as his deputy, we made sure to call out military spouses specifically in our revised vision statement. The vision statement for DOL vets is to enable all veterans, transition services, and military spouses to reach their full potential in the workplace. It's absolutely important we look at the whole family unit. As we move past the pandemic in our nation, we are excited to see that the unemployment rate for veterans is so low. The July number, as I mentioned, is 2.7%. But that doesn't mean we have to stop working. It is that much more important that we get everything in place, because at some point, it's not going to look like that, and the economy will change, and we need to be ready. One thing that we know is that the pandemic really highlighted and exacerbated existing economic inequalities. And we can see that in a number of veteran communities who experience higher unemployment rates. This is DAV, so I would be remiss if I didn't talk about disabled veterans. And what we see is that for veterans with a 60% or higher disability rate, they have a lower participation rate in the employment of the labor force compared to veterans with a disability rating of less than 30%. Disability rating less than 30%, participation of the labor force, 94%. our three key priorities and deal best is promoting and advancing equity, inclusion, and accessibility in underserved veteran communities. This includes disabled veterans, rural communities, Native American communities, LGBTQ+ communities, justice involved, women veterans, and anybody who is historically marginalized that might need this assistance from us. Every veteran deserves a good job with family sustaining wages. Recently, the Department of Labor had an initiative called the Good Jobs Initiative, you might have heard about it, where all of government leaders come together to discuss the future of work and how we can make sure that all American citizens have access to quality work. And of course, in our space, we're focusing on veterans, transitioning service members, and elderly spouses. The labor dynamics show that Americans are leaving jobs to get better jobs. It is really a job seeker's market right now. So we want to make sure we capitalize on that, make sure that our veterans have the best opportunities. And as I mentioned earlier, there are different paths to career opportunities. Back in, like, a long time ago when I was a rehab counselor, it was really challenging to look at things like apprenticeship and OJT. Apprenticeship was lesser known, and it was more focused on blue collar, which not every veteran was interested in. And as many veterans who didn't want to go to college, they didn't want to sit in a classroom and learn about, you know, humanities and you know, algebra and all these things. They wanted to get to work and they wanted to be productive and earn, you know, sustaining wages. Now we're in such a better place with an apprenticeship. There's so many more opportunities in cybersecurity, for example, in industrial base. Employers are no longer unnecessarily requiring higher education degrees for jobs that don't require it. We are working with all sorts of industries to clear pathways to get veterans into those industries. We just hosted last week a clean energy roundtable that included Department of Energy, industry associations, training providers, and employers. We also worked with the White House on the trucking challenge to get more Americans to take jobs in the trucking industry. We were very clear in our involvement in all of these initiatives that when we are talking about veterans, they need good wages, good benefits, good working conditions. So we're happy to work with any industry that brings that to the table for veterans. Which is why another one of our priorities is to leverage partnerships to enhance employment outcomes for veterans. Partnerships such as the ones that we have with you, with DAV and with other VSOs, partnerships with federal government, partnerships with other NSOs and nonprofits, and partnerships with all of the organizations that we provide grant funding to. In terms of the federal government, Department of Labor enjoys a really great relationship with the Department of Veterans Affairs, with the Veterans Benefits Administration, also with the Veterans Health Administration. I mentioned suicide prevention earlier. We are partnering with VHA to provide suicide prevention training to all of our disabled veteran outreach program coordinators across the country. We're doing the basic training that they already have, SAVE training, but we're also developing a tailored initiative just for DVOCs to not only help them recognize when a veteran might be in crisis, but also to recognize how to be more proactive in terms of oxygen effects and help that veteran and stay in touch with that veteran and provide the right level of service and the right level of referrals quite often to the VA. The next priority I want to talk about is getting the military to civilian transition right. We have so many initiatives in this space because we serve veterans who have been out any amount of time, but we also want to be proactive for that service member who's going to be getting out of the military. If we can get as much of that right before they get out, that would be just serve so many difference in terms of getting them on the right track. And we know we have a limited opportunity. We have a very limited opportunity. We have a one-day training course in the week-long transition assistance program. It's basically mandatory, although service members can opt out of that course. And then we have two optional courses that can nail which track they want to go in. But it's a classroom experience. If you've been through classroom experience, you know it's not enough. It is not enough. So we started the Employment Navigator Partnership Pilot. Employment Navigators are individual career counselors that are on military installations, or at training installations right now. And they work one-on-one with that service member after they've gone through TAP. And what they do is they do the one-on-one service based on that service member, where they're at, and what they start by looking at your interests, your abilities, how much money you think you can, you want to make, where you want to live. There's so many factors involved in that one-on-one conversation, and draw that out of the service member, and that's what they're doing. But more importantly, we know that once they leave that military installation, we no longer necessarily have access to them. Maybe we got them into our system, and that'd be great if they're in the American Job Center network, and then we can continue to serve them. But sometimes they don't register. So what we want to make sure is that we have a good job to community partners. And so the EMPP program has vetted partners that are part of our program. And those navigators learn about those partners, and they connect the service member to a partner that makes the most sense for them based on their journey and their needs. These partners can be anything from job matching, it can be wraparound services, mentoring. There's a whole host of services that we vet these partners with. And organizations like DAV and other CSOs are also partners, and we partner with organizations that you also partner with, like the football team, for example. So we have consistently, so I was at VA for 26 years, and one of the things I knew about transition is that consistently across all my time at VA, it was always the service members, the feedback we got is like drinking from a fire hose. There is so much coming at you, it's really hard to absorb it all. And then when you leave, the reality hits, and now you're out there in the world of being a veteran, you kind of go, oh wow, I wish I could go back and spend a little more time thinking about it. So all that to say, we now have an off-base transition training pilot as well. And this pilot is in 5 states right now. And what we're doing is dropping veterans of any era an opportunity to come in and basically do a TAP-like experience, but it's not exactly like TAP. Because if you were going to sit through a whole day course, and you're a veteran, and you've been out of the military, you don't want to sit through an all day course. You may not need all of the components of what TAP had to offer. But maybe you want to learn how to use LinkedIn properly. Maybe you want to learn better job interviewing skills. Or maybe you just need to really beef up your resume and get it right. Or maybe you just don't even know where to start and you want to get a new occupation. So this off-base transition training pilot in these 5 states provides that experience. It is both in person in the 5 states at the classrooms across those states, and it's also virtual. So even if you're not in one of the 5 states, you can still participate in the modular system. So what we did is we broke up the important components of TAP from a job seeking perspective. We broke it into the specific modules. So you can register for all the modules, or you can register for just the one that you want. And so you don't have to spend your whole day there if you don't want to. So I wanted to mention, this is a new initiative. So thank you in advance for getting the word out, by the way. I know we've been working with DAV to get the word out about the PTT, because it is hard to market these kinds of services and make sure the veterans who actually need the services know about them. But, so the proactive piece is the employment advocate, right? So we've got them, we're on the military installation with them. We have to date served 5,327 service members and 365 military spouses. With OVTT, so far it's much newer. We've had 670 participants attend 805 in-person modules, and we've had 191 participants attend 111 of the virtual modules. We are recruiting customer feedback from our veterans and service members who participate in these initiatives. And not only is the feedback both in terms of the statistics, over 96% satisfaction, but we're also getting, I would definitely tell my friends, colleagues, peers about this program. It's very beneficial. It's increasing their confidence and their ability to get good jobs. And some of the quotes that we get around the life-changing these experiences have been, have really just been inspirational and motivating us to continue to expand. I talked about military spouses and the important role that they serve in that military member's life. We also recognize the need to target transition assistance programming to them as a separate audience. We know they can sit in the TAP class with their spouse, if they're going through transitions, but it's different. That course is aimed at the service member that's transitioning. The military spouse experience is different. So we have a TAP program just for military spouses. It's called Transition Employment Assistance for Military Spouse. Of course, we love acronyms. The acronym is TEAMS. And the TEAMS workshop is also modular and I can help military spouses with their resume, with LinkedIn, with navigating licensure portability. And fiscal year to date, we've had 823 military spouses attend 203 separate modules of this training program. And also, a new thing that we did this past year is we created a Wounded Warrior and Caregiver Employment Workshop. So this is basically a TAP individualized session just for Wounded Warriors. It focuses on things like disability accommodation, self-advocacy, and just really tailoring the TAP employment experience to the Wounded Warrior. We work with DOL's Office of Disability Employment Policy. We work with DAV and other VSOs. We work with the Department of Veterans Affairs. And we also work with the Military Services Wounded Warrior Programs to make sure we got all of the concerns that everybody in the ecosystem knew about what veterans had to navigate when they had disabilities. And again, we're proactive, left side of PB214. Let's get them while they're still there and get them on the right track. It also includes caregivers. So that, again, is just all the different ways that we are trying to deal with vets to not just be okay with just TAP, but really leaning into all the special populations, making sure we tailor our program to them, and as much as possible, make it one-on-one. And I know that I'm over my time, so 20 minutes, so I wanted to mention those three initiatives to you. And again, thank you so much for your partnership, collaboration, and for helping us to get the military disability transition right, to reach our underserved veteran populations, and to make sure that we enhance partnerships to improve our loan outcomes. And with that, I can take questions for as long as we have time to take questions.
I have a couple of questions. We have a mic up.
Former men, Mark Fripp, Chapter 26, Maryland. What five states are you around the process?
Great question. California, Massachusetts, let's see if I can do this from memory. You know, there are times that I have to memorize, and there are times that I lose the memorization. California, Massachusetts, you know, of course, any time that I didn't have a podium and everybody's staring at me. Here we go. California, Pennsylvania, Texas, Massachusetts, and North Carolina.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Good evening. I'm Dean Birch, the Virtual Service Operations. Retired Army. One, I just wanted to say that in the 5 years I've been retired, things within DOL, the ease of navigating, particularly for a very small company like mine that I helped start when I got active, improved drastically. Partnerships with DAV and other organizations make it so much better. I did have a couple questions that maybe I'm unclear on, and the first one would be in regards to, and we have a 26% employment rate in our company with veterans, so we focus. Every account lead has to show us that they've interviewed at least 2 veterans for every position. It's very focused on that. And we want to push towards the spouses as well. I myself have friends came back much worse off than I am, and their wives are the primary caregivers. How do we report? When I do look at it from, you know, the business side, is DOL planning on shifting so that it's easier? Because when I do apply for the higher vessel award, or I apply for other things, I can only report on my veteran numbers. That veteran spouse is a nice thing, if that makes sense. Is there any changes being thought on benefits for businesses? Because we all know that that's what will drive businesses to hire those spouses. Nice goes a certain amount of way. Being able to do something with it goes farther.
Oh no, I totally agree, and absolutely, one of our policy areas that we are working on, and I can only share so much, but it's specifically in that military spouse arena, and you're right, and even in federal employment, it's the same thing. You know, when I was at VA and now at DOL, responses, how to preserve the employer side of it and make sure that they, that Milton Shaw's rights are protected, first of all, in terms of non-discrimination, but also helping employers to get the credit that they deserve when they are hiring employee spouses. And we're also working on the best value program because there are some challenges in there, and so we're working with lawmakers to take a look at that program.
And my second one, I'm trying to make sure, is that I know that DOD owns the program, if we use SkillBridge, but it's been very successful throughout the industry, particularly the IT industry. And is there any possibility, again, veterans' spouses could get involved in that? And there are huge rumors going around the industry that SkillBridge isn't funded through, which obviously, I'm the veterans program director, I have to make budget choices about what I try to leverage past my MOU expiring next August. Is there any word on that in particular, and if apprenticeships like that could include spouses as well?
I know that there's been some new legislation in the past that would really expand the program to military spouses. From our viewpoint and our partnerships with DOD, we know some of the challenges that they've got, but we don't see SkillBridge going away. In fact, we see a continued increase in terms of the opportunities that service members are using SkillBridge for, and the number of employers that are reaching in and making SkillBridge opportunities happen, because they're realizing, you know, we don't need to wait for that service member to get out of the military, use their GI Bill, get a bachelor's degree. We need to get them now. Their skills, they're great workers. I was just at Raytheon in Massachusetts, and it was amazing walking through the floor of their factory, and they pulled out all the veterans to talk to me, and there were a few that had just been in SkillBridge. A couple were still, you know, active duty, had transitioned out, and the sense of mission, like that they felt, going right from the military into an organization that was providing to the military, was just amazing. So we recognize the value of SkillBridge, DOD recognizes the value, and we're partnering together to make sure they live together.
It really does help. I mean, our motto is get veterans' careers, not just jobs. And thank you guys for all that you do. God bless you.
Thank you for what you do.
We have to move along, though, so Ms. Devlin can get on the road, but she may be able to answer a question on the way out. But before she goes, we want to present her with a small token of our appreciation. I was hoping the National Commander would be in the room. So Ms. Devlin, on behalf of the National Commander and Marshall, and Anthony, our gorgeous course, spouse of a veteran, we want to ensure that you have the tools and the resources needed to embark on meaningful employment, not just to get a job. We want to ensure that meaningful employment equates to careers. We want to ensure we align veterans and their spouses with career opportunities that they enjoy or they're interested in. We want to make sure they get trained, certified, so that a host of different things that we do when we engage with the veterans and the spouses to ensure that they understand, you know, where they can go for answers, where they can go for training, how they can link up with some of these companies and corporations that want to hire them. And that's what we do day in and day out. For some of the resources you get on our website, you'll see these tabs, you know, job fairs, veterans and spouses, employers, hiring guide, publications, entrepreneurship. So we just acquired a good bootcamp, as everyone heard through the commander's testimony, and, as well as Executive Director Barry Justin Husky's comments yesterday. That's a big deal. We have a lot of suffering service members and veterans that have creative minds. They want to engage and they want to integrate into society, but they want to do it their way through their businesses. So we're very happy to be able to offer veterans and spouses the entrepreneurial resources and information. And also we're going to be conducting events that's going to enable them to learn A to Z on what it takes to take their idea and make it happen. And we're very, very proud to be able to do that. On our webpage is averaging about 5,000 visits a month, which is pretty good. Obviously, we hope it continues to grow as our resources evolve with the needs of the veterans and their spouses. Our job fair schedule is, you know, pretty robust. It hasn't been as robust as it was prior to COVID. We've been doing 140 a year. So this year, you know, we did we'll do about 86 by the time it's done. And that's a mixture of traditional job fairs as well as virtual events. We have just a few kiosk events that we do, but next year, we haven't seen our schedule for next year from the military, so we're kind of hoping it's going to be a little more robust. We're thinking it's going to be about 90, but we're going to do more military bases next year than we are virtual events. And right now, with 200,000 here. That is the pipeline corporate America is going to through SkillBridge program, government agencies, and that's where we need to make sure we touch them before they get off active duty and let them know it's available to them. Well, we also have the veterans and spouses section. We have a veterans job search engine, and that's Recruit Military, our corporate partner, maintains that. And it's kind of ironic. We have low unemployment rates, 2.7% for veterans, 3.4% for civilians. However, if you look on this job board, there's over 400,000 jobs available. So it's kind of interesting how that dynamic is happening, and we're trying to figure out, you know, how that can be. How can we have such low unemployment rates and so many employment opportunities available? The Great Resignation took place last year. 47 million people bailed out of employment, and we're still trying to figure out where a lot of them went. So that is the question everyone's trying to answer. But what we need to make sure that every veteran, every spouse, and suffering service member has the ability to identify their next mission or their next career. And that's what we want to do, to ensure that we align them accordingly. So there's a lot of jobs available right now. And the search engine goes to a job board that is veteran-centric, which means only veterans and suffering service members can use it. So it's veteran-centric, it's employers that want to hire veterans and their spouses because of the soft skills that we as veterans possess. The employment resources we have, the Patriot Employer Program. So we launched this last fall. The Patriot Employer Program is designed to recognize those employers or hiring entities that hire, train, and retain veterans and their spouses. So this year we received about 24 of them within a 4 or 5 month period, which was very, very good. We will continue to receive those. I would encourage everyone in here to look at this website, to look at the Patriot Employer Program. If you know of a company, corporation, or hiring entity that hires, trains, and retains veterans, we've made it simple for you to apply through our website. Really, really quick to do so. Anybody can nominate a company. I just ask this. If you If you know the company, be sure to fill out the application. We need information to do our due diligence to ensure that we can follow up to make sure that, yes, they do hire, retain, and, you know, maintain a veteran workforce or even spouses in the workforce. But we want to recognize them, and we want to make sure that they get that recognition. And they also feel good about getting things from the DAV, the most critical veteran service organization in the country, saying, you know, they are a veteran employer. It's something everywhere wants, and they don't have to buy their ads like you do through the Department of Labor. And speaking of the badges, here they are. So we have three categories, small, medium, and large. And each will get a digital badge. They also receive an award on stage like they did yesterday. We also have 9 subcategories that we provide digital badges for hiring and retaining, and all those categories underneath that go with that. So it's very, very important that we identify these employers, we recognize them, and right now, employers want designations on their websites to show that they are veteran friendly, and these digital badges, they can go to Joe Baker, and they post social media, and they serve all through their social networks. So the program is growing, it's evolving, and we hope to see more applications throughout the year, just not through a 4-month period itself. If you know about entities that hire veterans, please let us know. I encourage them to submit a nomination packet or nominate you yourself. So the job fairs. We travel all over the country and we conduct these job fairs. Brian and I have done a lot of travel. Jared will start getting in travel. And I'll tell you, we are title sponsors of all of these events. So we have a booth up front. And we're not only there to engage with the veteran or separating service member or spouse or we also have NSOs, TSOs on military bases that assist us at these job fairs. So when a veteran or spouse or a separating service member comes to our booth, not only are they getting deployment information, they're getting the advantage information. So it's a one-stop job line. And we're very, very happy we can do that. And I want that to Marsline and the service staff for affording us the ability to have the NSOs and TSOs participate in these events with us. Very, very important. So we're also all over social media. Our comms team does a great job to make sure that our events and our information is pushed out on all of our channels. And anybody can tag us and share, and we want that to happen, because the more information that's out there, the better equipped the veteran and their spouse is going to be to actually link up with that employment opportunity or career opportunity. And like they say, Margarita, Ms. Devlin said, in her remarks, there's a lot of folks out there that are working, but they're also looking for better opportunities. And they say the best time to look for a job is in that. So these folks are out there, they're looking. We have a lot of folks come to the job fairs, they're already employed, but they're either not respected, they don't feel like they're appreciated, and they may be underemployed. So we want to make sure they're paying for employee, and we want to make sure they align with veteran-friendly employers. That's our goal. So job fairs, since the inception of our program in June 2014, we've done this slide's probably about 3 or 4 short, but over 825 job fairs for sure, and which is a big deal. That's a lot of job fairs. We have 266,000 attendees at these events. We've had over 41,000, almost 42,000 exhibitors attending to events. Those are the folks that are hiring veterans. And right now we're seeing a lot of job offers come through. We've engaged with over 118,000 veterans and their spouses and service members through these events. Because we're the first booth, so they either see us coming in or they see us going out. We want to touch all of them to make sure they're aware of DAV and what we offer them and their spouses as they navigate getting weaved back into the fabric of society. It's very important that they have their recognition. We want to help them identify that. And job offers, we've seen a lot of job offers coming from these events, 162,000 plus since the inception of the program. That's a big deal. That's a lot of employers hiring veterans and giving them job offers. And some veterans at these events, we've seen multiple job offers to the same candidates just going through a 4-hour event. So it's very robust. There's a lot of job opportunities out there. And the speaker has the leverage. There's no doubt about it.